Hello, everyone. My name is Austin Wilkins. I'd like to welcome you to tonight's symposium. Sorry we're getting started a little bit late today. So this is the annual symposium for the annual survey of American law here at NYU. We are a student-edited journal publishing 4 issues every year. Before we get started, I want to thank a few people. First of all, Mr. Michael Roberts, for all of his help as our symposium editor putting this event together. I'd also like to thank, give it together for Michael. I'd also like to thank our panelists and our moderators for sharing their time with us tonight out of their busy schedules. And of course, I'd like to thank all of our editors at the annual survey for all of your work this year and the work that you might be doing on material that comes out of this event. So each year we hold this symposium to examine in depth an issue that we want to learn more about this year. As a journal that covers recent developments in American law, it's important for us to bring together a few of the experts on an area that really intrigues us this year. Tonight, our ceremony will be on the so-called sharing economy. Our discussion will feature diverse viewpoints by panelists who represent experts in the field from government, private practice, academia, industry, and journalism. Our 2 panels this evening will address, first, the role of local regulation in the sharing economy, and second, the role of data privacy. After the panels, we'll have a keynote address by Harriet Pearson. And after that, we'll be having a reception generously sponsored by the law firm of Wendels, Marks, Lane, and Mittendorf. Due to the growing prominence of the sharing economy, legal regimes, business models, and regulatory issues are constantly shifting. Firms in the sharing economy are causing a global disruption of industries. Companies such as Airbnb, recently valued at $10 billion, now carry higher valuations than former industry giants. With a valuation of more than $50 billion, Uber has outpaced companies such as Hertz and Avis and is closing in on companies such as Ford and Honda. In more than 1,000 international cities, people are able to share cars and homes. The sharing economy is rapidly expanding, and the market is huge, and so are the legal stakes, with regulators, practitioners, and lobbyists scrambling to find solutions with shared benefits. The sharing economy, powered by world-beating American technology firms, has created several unique sets of problems for the American legal system. As we speak, these issues are being resolved before legislative committees, within classrooms, and in courtrooms. Some of the most exciting aspects of this emerging dimension of the new economy will be discussed tonight. Our first panel will be discussing the sharing economy, technology, and municipal regulation. In recent years, companies like Uber and Lyft have disrupted traditional taxi and transportation services and clashed with regulators, causing politicians at all levels to speak out and even veto legislation. Similarly, Airbnb has come under fire in some cities, especially this one, for violating local occupancy and zoning laws. While New York has been relatively hostile toward Airbnb, other municipalities, such as San Francisco, have recently passed laws allowing short-term rentals. This first panel will ask whether the sharing economy undermines or reinforces much of the premise of municipal regulation of industries. And if so, what should be done about it? Our moderator for this first panel is Professor David Schleicher. He's an associate professor of law at Yale Law School and is an expert in land use, local government, and urban development. His work has been published widely in academic journals and the popular press. He has been called the most important thinker on local government by the National Review. Professor Schleicher is a graduate of Harvard Law School and holds a master's from the London School of Economics and an undergraduate from Dartmouth College. The panelist sitting to Professor Schleicher's left is Matthew Daus. He is a partner at Windels, Marks, Lane, and Mittendorf, as well as a distinguished lecturer at the City College of New York. Before joining the law firm to lead its transportation practice, Mr. Daus served as commissioner and chairman of the New York City Taxi and Limousine Commission for 8.5 years. Mr. Daus serves as a distinguished lecturer with the United States Department of Transportation's University Transportation Research Center at the City University of New York, and continues to serve since 2009 as pro bono president of the International Association of Transportation Regulators, a nonprofit educational and advocacy organization comprised of government transportation commissioners and regulators from around the world. Mr. Daus received an LLM in employment law from NYU and his JD from Toro College, as well as a bachelor's from Brooklyn College. Our next panelist, Professor Arun Sundararajan, is from the NYU Stern School of Business and studies how digital technologies transform business and society, focusing on peer-to-peer markets, digital labor, new institutions, regulation, inequality, social networks, and online privacy. He has provided expert input about the crowd-based sharing economy as part of congressional testimony. His recent commentary has appeared in publications including The New Yorker, The New York Times, The Financial Times, The Washington Post, and The Wall Street Journal. Our next panelist is Joseph Okpaku, Director of Public Policy and Vice President of Government Relations for Lyft. He is based in San Francisco, California, where he oversees the company's efforts to ensure that legislation or regulations that are implemented are appropriate to the transportation network company model for Lyft. Joseph received his bachelor's from UCLA and his JD from Georgetown University Law Center. Our next panelist is Jonathan Horton, the general manager of SpotHero, an on-demand parking mobile app and website-based marketplace that connects parking lots, parking garages, and valet services with drivers who need to find and reserve them. He is a veteran of Zipcar, where his focus was on improving operations and strategy in New York. After serving as general manager at Zipcar, John joined SpotHero as the general manager of New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. So, I would like for everyone to join me in welcoming tonight's first panel.
So, thanks so much for having us. I think this is going to be really fun. Before we get into the panel's fireworks, though, I want to just do a little bit of definitional work to kind of explain what it is we're talking about. People toss around the sharing economy, and then other people say, well, there's not much sharing involved. And so I want to just do a little bit of a little deep description to kind of say, what is the universe of things we're going to talk about? And so when we say the sharing economy, we largely mean two types of businesses. The first one you might think of is micro-rentals, some product that's traditionally been rented before but now gets rented in smaller and smaller increments of time. So think Zipcar or Car2Go or the city bikes that you can get at just outside. These are all things that were rented before but now are being rented in very small increments of time. The second business model is the platform. These businesses, Uber, Airbnb, Lyft, SpotHero, do what philosopher Robert Nozick once described as enabling capitalistic acts between consenting adults. The idea here is that there are drivers or providers of labor or providers of capital, people with houses, and they go on some kind of marketplace, and the company serves as some kind of middleman, and then there's a universe of consumers. And the question that emerges from these two types of businesses is, what's the big deal? And so there have been two kind of characteristic conflicts that we're going to talk about as we go forward here, and it's worth kind of focusing on which type of conflict we're talking about. The first one, and they're both flip sides of what make these businesses cool or exciting. Sharing economy services allow for the greater utilization of resources. One bike, rather than being parked regularly, can be used multiple times. This creates a signature type of conflict, which is there's greater utilization of the resource than is expected. So people think that people will be parked for a second or two, but instead there are going to be people coming in and out because it's a car to go or a zip car, and so there's going to be much more traffic. People expect someone will maybe have a house guest now and again in my apartment building, but then when it becomes an Airbnb, rented on Airbnb, there are regular people in and out. We end up with greater utilization of resources than we expect our regulation expects. So again, the flip side of what makes it cool is what makes it problematic. The second side is that these enable lots of transactions, particularly the platforms enable lots and lots of kinds of transactions that never happened before. So people would occasionally give each other's rides, even for money. People would occasionally rent out their apartments for short periods of time, but not that much. The platforms enable lots and lots of transactions to happen between lots of people who weren't in business before. This means that the kinds of people who work as hotel proprietors are not regulated, the same type of regulated professionals that we see in the general hotel industry. The people who work as cab drivers are not regulated by the TLC, but are just people with cars. And this enabling, the good side of enabling lots of transactions, which is lots of capitalist acts between consenting adults can happen, and that's exciting. On the other hand, we may be worried about the implications for consumer protection or other things that may emerge. So I want to start with Arun and ask the question, what is it that you think that makes people so mad about the sharing economy? Why is it that people, that arouses such passion? Most businesses exist and people don't think anything about them. Why do local governments particularly get so mad about this? And a kind of an alternate framing for the same question is, given that people are so mad about it, given that taxi drivers are so mad about it, hotel trades are so mad about it, neighbors to Airbnb are so mad about it, how does it possibly succeed?
All right, well, thanks for that question. And I also wanted to thank the audience for being here. I mean, if you guys weren't here, then we wouldn't have anybody to talk to.
That'd be depressing.
It happens on occasion, but you guys never get to see that. I think a couple of the characteristics that you highlighted about being sort of definitional about the sharing economy are in fact at the heart of why people get so mad about it. And one is, you characterized it as, transactions that used to be occasional are now becoming frequent. I sort of think of it more broadly as sort of this blurring of lines between personal and professional, right? I mean, giving people rides to the airport, having people over for, like, lending your apartment to a friend, lending someone money, all of these are familiar, but they weren't commercial. And there were commercial analogs to them, like the taxi drivers, the restaurants, the banks, the sort of hotels, and they were regulated in a particular way. And so as we've blurred, I think what frustrates city governments sometimes is that there's new economic activity which seems promising. One way of looking at the sharing economy is that it's creating work, right? I mean, it's creating sort of productive, the production of services. But on the other hand, the activity that it's enabling often doesn't fit neatly into sort of the regulatory boxes that were built, right? And so that's one source of, frustration. I think another is also sort of a point you alluded to, but the emergence of these platforms, right? In many cases, the peer-to-peer activity that used to take place, whether it was government-sanctioned or casual, happened sort of bilaterally between the taxi driver and the taxi passenger, between the bed and breakfast owner and the guest. Between the restaurant and the sort of person who wanted to eat there, right? And in that kind of bilateral interaction, it was necessary to have certain kinds of government intervention, often at the local level, in order to keep things safe, in order to prevent market failure. We wouldn't have gotten into taxis 20 years ago unless, we had the TLC. I mean, this was sort of central. But with the emergence of the platform, now we've got this opportunity, right? And this is promising. You say, well, now there's an intermediary. There's someone else who is sort of sitting in between. Maybe they can start to do some of the things that the government had to do. But what ended up happening early on was they since there weren't sort of, you know, you combine these two things that, like, you know, something looks like taxi, something looks like hotel. The regulations don't fit, but meanwhile, the platform is saying, well, they don't fit, and we're going to figure out a way to make the market work. And so the platforms were ahead of the regulation. And, you know, that not only sort of highlights the misfit of the regulation, but it also makes it seem like the platforms are doing something that the government had to do, that the government used to do in a way that is potentially sort of threatening, right? And so, you know, the reason why I still think that, you know, despite, actually there are two other quick things, and then, you know, one is that, I mean, part of the challenge here is that, you know, we're not inventing new activities through these sharing economy platforms, right? We are inventing new ways of doing familiar things. And in some ways, this makes the regulatory challenge harder because we've already got old ways of regulating those old things rather than saying,
and people
well,
who are doing them.
Yeah, instead of saying, well, here's a whole new world, let's sort of start from scratch, right? I like it when the person sitting next to me on the panel is getting restive. You know, it sort of promises for like lively discussion to follow. So sometimes if they aren't getting restive enough, I sort of toss them a couple of sort of, so, you know, so I think the TLC has clearly outlived its, you know, it's, I like the TLC. I think they serve a useful purpose. And so in this sort of blurring of lines, you start to also hit up against things like zoning, right? Where, you know, there are easy solutions in some ways to some of the basic market failure problems, like safety, screening. But then it introduces other more challenging problems of, like, you know, and externalities are the ones. And I think this is part of what, like, you know, makes people other than the government mad with the sharing economy, because it sort of disrupts what used to be sort of a, like, you know, the meaning of a particular situation, whether it's, you know, someone has friends over for dinner, they don't have paying guests. Someone has guests over to stay in their apartment, they don't have a constant stream of people. And so that's sort of getting used to that. But the, you know, the important thing to realize here is that while we're seeing micro rental and sort of like, you know, the second thing what you said, like, you know, sort of capitalist sort of exchange, yes, between consulting adults, it's really important to realize that, you know, what we're seeing now, Uber, Airbnb, Get Around, SpotHero, we're sort of inventing a new model of organizing economic activity. Uber's not really a marketplace. Airbnb is not really, they are a marketplace, but they're also a firm, right? And so you've got some characteristics of sort of the 20th century organizational capital. You've got some characteristics of sort of 18th century Adam Smith capitalism. And they're being melded together into a new way of providing at scale things that, you know, 50 years ago used to require a company. And so we have to sort of fundamentally redefine some of the oversight, and like, you know, I think that's part of what draws people to them, right? You know, because, like, you know, it's very clear that there's a tremendous amount of value being created here despite the inconvenience.
Can you jump in?
Yeah, and I actually don't disagree with a lot of what you said, Aaron. You know, and, you know, look, I love capitalists consenting. It sounds like Uber XXX to me. But
it's their next business line. It's strange, but it's...
Look, why are people mad? I think it's a couple of reasons. Number one, it's the old versus the new. It's the technology lovers versus those who like it the old way. It's the millennials versus the Gen Xers and prior, whatever was before Gen X and Gen Ys. It's
Gen X.
Yes, and there may be some that are older that don't have a name for it. Baby boomers, maybe. It's a generational thing, and I also think You know, as David points out in some of his papers, you know, it's government versus the private industry. It's how do you regulate, why do you regulate, and it's the private sector versus government moving too slow. And, you know, look, as an old regulator, having worked for government for 20 years in total, you know, why are people angry? Look, if you go into any type of regulated industry, you're going to have usually the industry angry at the regulators because they ask questions and it's their job to tell you what to do. It's very simple, and we're a nation of law and order. And the other reason why people are mad is that you have libertarian and Adam Smith free market economists, and there are people who disagree with that, feeling that you should control markets and can't control markets. That's the essence of the dilemma. But, you know, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out then that when you go into a city and you just decide you don't move fast enough, I'm going to violate the laws, people are going to get mad. The people that are abiding by the laws, that have been regulated and been promised things, like promised medallions and told that you're going to, you know, make a great living on it and give the city your money, which we did, you know, to the tune of $200 million plus, people are going to be angry, and rightfully so. And you know, these are the conflicts that are underlying the debate. It's philosophical, it's economics, it's government versus private sector, and I think that's the essence of it. And, you know, I think we're going to come out of this, like you've mentioned in some of your works, going full circle. Everything could potentially just break down, and then we're going to have to build it up. And this isn't the first time it's happened. Deregulation has happened time and time and again. We have a medallion system in New York because, yes, we had a market failure. People were throwing their medallions away during the Great Depression because they couldn't earn a living. There was too many cars on the street. I think, you know, look, I want to first of all thank my, we're having class here tonight, by the way, City College graduate students, my transportation technology class. They're here in the audience. We discuss these things every day. The issue of transportation professionals. I am one. I hang out with them all day long. The people that wrote the books since the 70s, the Plowden Report, all of these folks who have been planning cities, Jeanette Sada Khan, all of the people who've been planning cities for the last, you know, I would say 30 years, have been anti-car. And there's another conflict here. They want to get cars and personal motor vehicles, which is part of the essence of the sharing economy, out of the central business district. People are moving to cities, they're living longer. By 2030, everyone's going to be living in urban environments, and we're going to be sharing bikes, we're going to be sharing rides. But the problem that we have here is that the TNC model, the transportation network company model, and what's happened in the last two to three, if not 4 years, has led to an explosive, unregulated growth in the car. And I think eventually there's going to be a backlash by transportation professionals, not at the taxi and limo level, but at the deputy mayor level, at the transportation commissioner level, who's saying, God, what have you done to my city? I spent the last 30 years getting rid of cars, congestion pricing in London, and now all of a sudden, you know, we have 1,000 of them. We're going to have to share, as I guess we're starting to do now.
Yeah, so right? I want to move to Joseph for a second. So I want to get our business people in here. If you, Joseph, if you had a mayor, a new mayor elected, and you had 3 minutes to tell them something, three-ish minutes, to tell them something that they don't know about the sharing economy, and that they should structure the way they think about it, what would you tell them?
I suppose if I only had 3 minutes, I would have to talk very quickly because I'd want to say a lot. The first thing I would want to explain is exactly what ride sharing is about and what it's trying to accomplish, because...
And we can talk more broadly than ride sharing also, but
sure.
You get started.
But, you know, specifically for the industry that I work in, I think there are a lot of misconceptions about what ride sharing is trying to accomplish, what it is not. And as a starting point, before you begin to try to regulate something, I think it's our duty as an industry to make sure that the people who are trying to regulate it understand what it is that they're trying to regulate. So my first, I would spend maybe the first minute trying to explain what ride sharing is truly trying to accomplish. Yes, there's no doubt that there are similarities between ride sharing and incumbent industries in that, you know, we are transporting a person from point A to point B, but already within the existing industries, we already see different regulations for different types of transportation providers. So it's incumbent upon me as a representative of the TNC industry to explain why our industry is different and why we need regulations to account for those differences. So that's how I'd spend the first minute. I also think that there is a fairly pervasive narrative that that technology companies in general, and perhaps ride-sharing specifically, are anti-regulation. I very strongly disagree with that. I think that nothing has been more important than to solidify the legitimacy of our industry than appropriately tailored regulation. And just as a point of background, when I started in this position 2.5 years ago, there was only one state that had actually issued regulations for the ride-sharing industry, that being California. As of a couple of weeks ago, now 30 states have enacted some sort of legislation that governs the ride-sharing field. So that is good for the industry. That is a recognition that this is something different and distinct from existing providers of transportation. But it also recognizes that there are ways that we can address the legitimate regulatory goals, safety, accountability, that may be different than what a regulatory agency or local government might be used to doing, but can still accomplish the same goals. So those would be the first two things that I would focus on. I think at that point my 3 minutes would be up, but I would probably try to keep talking after that.
David, I'd be willing to give him an extra minute to explain the first minute that he suggested, you know, basically how are TNCs and Lyft different from taxis and limos, because I can't still figure that out at this point. So maybe, can we give him an additional minute? I mean, because that's really why we're here, aren't we?
No, I'd be glad to. And as a starting point, recognize that here in New York City, it's very different than the way TNCs operate everywhere else. In New York City, Lyft operates as essentially a black car. They use professional drivers who have been licensed by the TLC. For all intents and purposes, our drivers here are professional TLC licensed drivers. Everywhere else, however, it is a peer-to-peer platform where people like everybody in this room who want to make a few extra bucks during their spare time or during the summer break, if they have a car that meets the standards, if they have a clean criminal background record, clean driving record, can use your own personal vehicle to provide rides on the platform. And that's what we operate across the country. Allowing people to do that has significant benefits that I don't think incumbent transportation providers can offer. And the one easy example that I'll provide is something like Lyft Line. Lyft Line is a product that we launched about a year and a half ago, I want to say now, where multiple people who are going in the same direction can share a ride going to that common destination or to a point along that common route. So basically, it means that strangers can share the same ride, get to the same general location for about half the cost. This is something that you see in Europe and Africa. The sharing of rides is something that's very common everywhere else. But here in the United States, it is rather uncommon. In fact, I think it's fairly safe to say that it's rare. In just over a year, however, in San Francisco, 50% of rides in San Francisco are Lyft Line rides. That is something that is, in our opinion, rather astonishing. It's actually faster than we thought in terms of the adoption of Lyft Line. And it's something that is really changing social norms. But the only way that that works is if you have, instead of a fleet of 40 drivers or a fleet of 100 drivers, you need to have a platform of a community where people are driving 10 hours a week, 15 hours a week, so that you have the critical mass that there are enough people going in enough directions to be able to match two people going into the same direction. So that would be my first example of how TNCs differ from existing transportation options.
So I get Jonathan in here. If you had a mayor, and you've been in a couple of different types of sharing economy firms, you've kind of been around the industry, what would you tell them?
You know, it's funny, and we talked about why people are so mad at the sharing economy or on-demand economy. Why are people so mad when you take it away from them? You saw in New York, I've never seen so many people upset. The only other time I saw people upset like that in New York is when they threatened to get rid of unlimited brunch on Sundays. That's the only other time I saw that many people on social media up in arms. And I think the reason that they're so upset is that it fits a need, and it does have benefits. What does it have for benefits for the consumer? Well, a lot of times it saves them money. So Zipcar, for example, my previous company, we used to do calculations about the thousands of dollars you'd save by sharing a car. And the benefit to the public from that is that every Zipcar would take 14 privately owned cars off the road. So right there, there's a certain benefit to both the consumer and society, or the economy, or pollution, however you might want to look at it. And then with my new company, traffic congestion, 30% of all traffic congestion comes from people looking for parking. So if they're able to already know where they're going, pay for it, and then we direct them there, and it actually routes you around traffic, we're actually helping to reduce traffic, which actually goes back to the point of we should stop having cars come in. That'd be very unfortunate for my new company. But we do want to help the cities. And I think a lot of the companies out there do want to help. And I think that if they had waited for the regulations to be in place, they wouldn't say this to the mayor, but if they were to wait for the regulatory actions to take place, there wouldn't be that that anger from the consumer that really wants it. So I think it was smart the way they rolled out, but that's just my opinion as a guy from the startup. It's often do now and ask for forgiveness later. And so in awe of the expansion of Uber and Lyft, and I remember being at Zipcar, and I'm like, wait, no one's talking about us anymore. And so they just came on out of nowhere. And so I don't know if that happens if you wait for the regulatory action to take place.
So I want to move back to Matt and Aaron on the question of, so let me flip it around. What if you had, say, two leading sharing economy people with you, and let's say you had all of them. You had Travis Kalanick, and you had the Airbnb guys. What would... Or you were just at Davos doing this, so I saw some of it. What would you tell them about how do you think they should relate to cities? So, what is their approach of sit now and ask for forgiveness later the right approach, or is a different method what's called for now?
Well, I would say that you should have a dialogue, and you know, to their credit, Lyft does have a dialogue, Uber doesn't. Though Lyft, frankly, you guys basically do the same thing that Uber does for the most part. So it's just a friendlier, like, I'm going to do what I want anyway. You know, which is fine, you know. I think when it comes to this, you know, if I had to tell Travis, which I've told him, and that's why, you know, I decided not to work for him when he approached me 5 years ago, I told him, look, you know, this is not going to fly. Now, I was wrong.
I might take policy advice from you, but definitely not business advice.
Yeah, well, anyway, I made one exception. I think he was onto something that nobody else saw, which is that you had a millennial generation that was into technology, was riled up about just having your own sort of revolution. And it really is a revolution, and it's generational. And, you know, another thing that makes people mad, too, getting back to that, is something which I think millennials can relate to. The reason why Bernie Sanders has all this support, right? It's because people are angry at the people who have a lot of money that just get whatever the hell they want. And that, frankly, is what has happened here. Okay, Travis, who, I mean, I disagree with his methods, and he did have a brilliant business strategy, but he went out there and said, I have, you know, a Travis manifesto that if regulators don't shut me down in 30 days, I'm just gonna do whatever I want. And I'm going to spend $100 million, which he did, on lawyers and lobbyists. Not a bad thing for NYU law students to think about. It's not, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with spending money on lawyers, but basically they got whatever they want, and they still do. It's campaign contributions, it's lobbyists, it's lawyers. In Chicago, they basically hired every lobbyist that was left. And you know what? I don't know if that's the right message to be sending to people. And frankly, I think the people that are of the millennial generation who are all riled up about Occupy Wall Street and some of these issues, they should really think about the contradictions between your support of these TNCs and their methodologies and your support of some political candidates.
So, well, the one thing to note, I'm gonna move to Arun in a second, but is the taxi industry is wildly outspent all the TNCs across on lobbying over the years, and the same thing's true with the hotel and the hotel unions versus Airbnb. So there's a point of fact that doesn't seem right. But Arun, what would you tell the CEOs?
Okay, well, I mean, you covered Uber really well,
yes,
so I'll leave Uber out, and I'll focus on Airbnb and Lyft,
yeah.
Which are companies I actually end up speaking to the leadership of more frequently. And, you know, I think both companies are actually doing a pretty good job of trying to work with cities. I'm looking at sort of the present, you know, and there's been sort of a learning curve, but I think that I'm an optimist about the sharing economy model in general in terms of the good it'll do for the world. And I don't think that that is emphasized enough. And I think that two dimensions of it that don't sort of, you know, aren't sufficiently part of the narrative of why this is good for your city, actually three. One is, the fact that it creates work, right? I mean, there is a city government that is supportive of sharing economy provision is going to have more people making money by doing things, you know? And as this increasingly becomes the model by which you earn a living, pro-sharing economy policy is akin to pro-job creation policy. The second thing that I don't see enough of, or maybe it's there, and like, you know, this is not, you know, this is not to say that it isn't part of your messaging, but like, you know, I'd like to see more of it, has to do with sort of the infrastructure creation piece. Maybe there's still logic even with sort of carpooling for, like, you know, cars not being the dominant mode of transportation in certain sort of central business districts. But there are vast sort of tranches of any city that are underserved by public transportation. And, you know, I think of things like Lyft or, like, you know, even Airbnb, or my favorite example from Europe, which is BlaBlaCar, which is city-to-city ride sharing. You buy a seat in someone else's car. They carry more people every day than Amtrak now. They have 25 million users. Is that you're sort of creating invisible infrastructure. You're creating infrastructure out of assets that are being underutilized by layering digital trust on top of this, and sort of playing up that we can help sort of create your infrastructure for you in this new public-private partnership. Mm-hmm. I think a third thing, which sort of is down the line, and I don't know how much it applies to Lyft, but it certainly applies to Airbnb and to Etsy and to some of these other peer-to-peer businesses, is that you know, there's certainly some sort of unhappiness about the sharing economy, but there's a lot more unhappiness about inequality. I think that we've reached a point where there was some sort of threshold that we crossed a few years ago, where you know, we all see the numbers about inequality in society, and like, you know, sort of, you know, income inequality and sort of economic inequality, and we have a sense for why it's sort of occurring. Part of why it's occurring is that, you know, the income stream to someone who owns capital grows faster than the income stream to someone who gets wages, everything else being equal. This is not my argument. This is Piketty's argument from, like, you know, Thomas Piketty from a couple of years ago. Now, one solution to that is to distribute the ownership of capital more broadly in society, right? If more and more people become owners of the means of production, then you're going to naturally reduce inequality. I think that there's a great opportunity for, you know, as more and more economic activity becomes sharing economy-like, there's sort of a decentralization of the ownership of the means of production. And so a message that supporting the sharing economy is actually sort of inequality reducing, it's a bit of a leap, and so, like, you know, as an academic, you know, I'm not saying it's got good foundations. I'm just saying that it's not happening right now, but in terms of sort of making that connection, if I was giving advice to, like, you know, Airbnb or Lyft or one of these platforms, I would sort of encourage them to make that connection more clearly. So it's sort of job creation, infrastructure, and invisible infrastructure and inequality.
So I have a question that's kind of related to that, yeah, which is one of the puzzles about the way the sharing economy is regulated today, in kind of cross-national comparisons, is that in almost every market in the United States, you can get an Uber or a Lyft. And those things are, there's some exceptions. New York is worse than other places for some of their services. This is not true in Europe. European countries have been very, very harsh on their regulation of the equivalent of UberX, UberPop. In contrast, in the United States, Airbnb is only been regularized in two markets and is illegal. Most of its services are illegal in most American markets. They exist and people use it a lot, but it's illegal. In Europe, it's the exact reverse. And so Airbnb services are lionized by city and national governments. Do you have any idea why? Do you have an instinct on why that is?
You know, it's interesting. I can't really speak for Airbnb. And as you probably know, Lyft does not operate internationally, so I haven't had any direct experience with this. What I can say, I guess, from observing this from afar, is that I think there's a lot of cultural norms and history that goes involved with any type of industry. And from what I understand, and again, not having any direct experience with this, the transportation industry is one in overseas that has I guess a lot more stronger historical roots in their regulatory framework than I would say the hospitality industry. I think that the expansion of the hospitality industry to include Airbnb is probably beneficial on an economic level in terms of tourism, whereas the same may not be said for the transportation industry. But beyond that, it's actually really difficult for me to say specifically because it's not something that I've directly delved into.
Yeah. I have some experience in this. I've done a lot of work in Europe. I've spent a lot of time there, Paris, London, Spain, on this issue. And I think it has a little bit to do with what you're saying, and I can only speak to really the Uber, the TNC crackdown. I think, first of all, you know, the TNC movement and these companies, and I think you can't divorce the companies from them. I mean, they're investigating Google for antitrust over there. It's an American thing, and they're not Americans. They're Europeans. There is a strong labor movement and strong unionization in Europe. And I believe that they look at this also from a tax perspective. And I spent a lot of time at the OECD and dealing with a lot of these issues in Paris. I think there's a sense that when a company, especially from America, comes that is well-financed, that they should be paying their fair share. Some of the economies, and I haven't heard the words ownership of the means of production since I read Karl Marx. But there is a socialist type of mentality in parts of Europe, very strong unions, people should be taxed. And what's really happening is, for Uber, for instance, I think there's resentment, because I've spoken to the regulators there, that they conduct business in London, they have their headquarters in Amsterdam, and a percentage of what they earn in London, from what I understand, goes to Amsterdam. Everything else goes to an offshore account in the Caribbean. So there's that tax issue. There's the right to be forgotten. Your keynote speaker, as a privacy expert, I'm sure will be talking about that. But the UK has a right to be forgotten law. And I think Europeans may have less of an enthusiasm as Americans do for giving up your rights when it comes to private companies sharing this information. I think it's all of those things plus what Joe mentioned.
I mean, can I just add a couple of, this is all just conjecture, but like a couple of things that, because this contrast has sort of struck me, and I think that it's not just a sort of a US versus Europe, but even within the United States, there's been different receptions in different cities. But on that US versus sort of Western Europe, I think, one possibility is that in many European cities, taxi service is better than in many US cities. I mean, New York is unique. New York has good taxi service. Most US cities don't. It's much more common to have sort of better taxi service in European cities. And so there's sort of that, this isn't quite as sort of that much better than the status quo for sort of the transportation. And on the accommodation side, I think that there could be a couple of reasons. I mean, and they're less regulatory and more sort of business and social, which is that the idea of sharing your apartment with someone commercially is perhaps more common in certain European cities than it is in the United States. It's something that a lot of us have done before Airbnb came along. And I think the idea of mixed-use real estate in cities is also sort of that mixing of the business and the residence is also more common in European cities than in American cities.
That's my instinct, too, for what it's worth, is that it's here our crazy regulation is land use, and there the crazy regulation is labor. And so that's the biggest distinction. I'll move to Jonathan again, which is 5 years from now, we'll do it in internet time. 6 months from now, where do you what parts of the sharing economy, particularly maybe parking, other things, do we think there's going to be the next big thing that we're going to fight about or be excited about? You could put a slash
there. Think obviously SpotHero will be the biggest company in the world at that point. I just started 6 months ago. Give me a little bit of time. I got a couple. One of my employees are here too. He's going to help me. So I think there's going to be it's going to be funny because I think there'll be consolidation, but I think there'll be expansion of offerings. And I think that those are going to fall under umbrellas of a Apple or a Google. And I think self-driving cars are going to change the game. And I think that Lyft and Uber have positioned themselves to be that replacement for infrastructure for transportation. And I think that, for example, there's talk of a railway or a train system in connecting Brooklyn and Queens, and the billions of dollars it'll cost, and you know maybe it'll be underwater by the time it's done. And you know, by that point, our driverless car is going to get rid of the need for that investment. And I think that money could probably be spent somewhere else. And so I think, you already see with the OEMs, they're getting into the game, and it'll be a few brands.
OEM,
owning it.
Question mark?
I'm sorry. I started my career at General Motors, and OEM is a car manufacturer. So yeah. General Motors has gotten in. Ford's made significant investments. BMW has even invested in parking technologies, which has already been, I think, out of business. And so I think all these things, you'll less companies, more offerings, but under the umbrella of these larger companies.
Take another hack at this?
Well,
Lyft is going to be the biggest company in the world.
I took a Lyft here, by the way. I had to make sure I told them that.
Much appreciated. And Lyft just partnered with your old company, GM. So I have to echo some of that answer, and that I do think that autonomous vehicles is going to significantly change the landscape. And I think that's something that's going to be coming sooner than people think. I think that can develop in multiple different ways, and I'm really curious to see how that plays out, whether we're talking about fully autonomous vehicles and a network of fully autonomous vehicles. As you say, that's reducing the need for personal vehicles on the ground, or whether we're talking about even people who own their own autonomous vehicles, and as they are at work in their car instead of sitting in a garage, maybe their car is being able to participate on a network and give people rides around then. I think as exciting and as revolutionary as this concept is going to be, and how close we are to being on the verge of it, we probably don't actually know what the full picture really looks like. But I do think that autonomous vehicles is the next big thing from my perspective.
So I want to pitch one idea and see what you all think before we move to the questions from the audience, which is that, so I've written a little bit about how I think part of the future of the sharing economy is government contracting. That rather than being opposed to cities, that they're going to be partners with cities across a huge number of things. And so some of the things we've seen, so Lyft works with the city of San Francisco on disaster preparation. If there's an earthquake, you're providing rides. What future do you think there is for government contracting in this field? So rather than being this opponent where Uber and the city of New York are at war with one another, you're going to be that rather than fighting the government, you're just going to be like everyone else, a regulated industry, making money from the fact that you're excluding others or whatever else it is. So what do you think the future of government contracting here is?
Well, I think Arun already touched on this. I think we're actually already starting to see it from just the perspective of a private-public partnership. Lyft has already partnered with a couple of transit agencies,
Think
that can be a really good symbiotic relationship in that not only are services like Lyft helping solve the last mile problem, allowing people to either not own a car or leave a car at home, but can also direct more traffic to existing infrastructure. So Arun was focusing on kind of the new infrastructure, but we're also really seeing how we can further and better utilize and take greater advantage of existing infrastructure by creating these types of relationships. And I think, again, this industry is brand new. We've only been around for, four years, and we're just starting to see the data as to how ride sharing can really help improve cities and transportation within urban areas. So I think a year from now, 2 years from now, we're going to be seeing an explosion in that regard.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think that there's tremendous opportunity here for the government and an increasing number of these platforms to sort of be on the same side. And we're going through a transition phase of sort of regulatory upheaval, and so they're on opposing sides, but they're natural allies on many fronts. So yesterday I was in San Francisco. I was at a computer science conference, and I sort of had a panel with the heads of data science from Airbnb, Lyft, and Uber, and we talked a lot about sort of some of the challenges and opportunities that sort of data-driven stuff. We also agreed that we would not use the phrase data-driven, but here I go. But one of the things that came up, and it's something that it has come up in discussion before, and it sort of speaks to your point of the intersection between the government and the platform, is something that I call sort of data-driven delegation. And you, some people think of it as algorithmic regulation, but it's a little different, which is, you know, there's often a feeling that it's good for a platform to give their data to the government so that the government can, is that sort of like last call, like, you know, time to go?
I think you said algorithmic regulation. Yeah, literally the room fell asleep.
I know,
so
it's sort of, yeah. Or maybe it was, you know, there was so much excitement that they decided to lower the lights to calm people down. Well, okay, so to,
from above.
You know, you know, I think that we're going to evolve from a place where we tell the platform, give your data to us, to a place where we say, you have the data, you have the machine learning and data science expertise. Here are a bunch of problems that, like, you know, we find hard to solve. Like, you know, yellow cabs not picking up people of particular ethnicities, or you know, you have the data, you come up with the algorithms to solve them. And that kind of sort of data-driven delegation of regulation, I think, will start to sort of strengthen partnerships.
If I could just add to that, I will predict the future. I don't agree, I agree with some, but mostly not all of what they all said so far. First of all, I think in 6 months to a couple of years, the TNC model is not going to exist anymore. They're going to lose in the courts. I believe that even if they don't, you know, unfortunately, we had that terrible tragedy in Kalamazoo, Michigan. I think that there's going to be a rethinking of the public safety element. And, I've read some of your work, Arun, you know, on self-regulation. Self-regulation could work in certain contexts when it comes to driver safety and people with criminal backgrounds and issues like that. The government should be making those decisions, not Uber and Lyft. And the information that you have in your files is not being shared. So I'll give you a perfect example. In Houston, Texas, there was a rape. 2 days after, I was in Austin, Texas at the legislature testifying. Uber got an hour and a half to speak. I got, after waiting for 3 hours, 3 minutes, and they cut me off because I was talking about a report saying the name checks that you guys do is not as accurate as biometric fingerprints. And then what happened is, which was beyond unbelievable for me as a lawyer, and for all of you should be outraged, Uber got up there and basically said, well, the information about this rape is proprietary and we're not releasing any information. You see, the reason why you really want to self-regulate is because you want to hold on to the information so that when an incident, a horrible incident like what happened in Kalamazoo, Michigan, is not data that the government has, which it should have, people should be held accountable for it, not basically holding a conference call, press release, where they're just basically giving information that they want you to know. You know, this is going to cause a rebuke to the TNC model. Even if it doesn't get thrown out in the courts, I think the selective reporting that's happening for every incident, you know, in any TNC around the world is going to cause a rethinking of the model. And you guys aren't going to be as big as you think you are now. I think you're going to be cut down to size a little bit. Taxis and limos are going to make a comeback. And I do agree with everything except the autonomous vehicles. I think government is going to get more data and they're going to share it. And it's going to be something that's going to benefit us. And people are going to be more akin to doing that. I think there's going to be a requirement or more policymaking on the sharing. I mean, Lyft and Uber did not do anything in the sharing economy for 2 years. It's a misnomer, and the Associated Press banned the use of the term. I commend you for putting Lyft Line in place. It kind of copied a business model that Via did, but now they have Uber Pool, Lyft Line, and Via. That is the sharing economy. You're going to see cities doing that everywhere. Autonomous vehicles, it ain't going to happen in our lifetime. I'm just telling you like it is. I worked for government for 20 years. Maybe in a retirement community, maybe in Disney, you have to have every car autonomous. You tell me how that's going to happen. You can fly a plane with no pilot, but is anybody getting into a plane without a pilot?
Okay,
now?
Can I agree with one thing that you said and then clarify? Well, I agree with you that there's probably a little more distance between now and the time that autonomous vehicles are widespread.
Okay.
And that the challenges are not technological, the challenges are elsewhere. They come from sort of like, you know, sort of working out sort of the mesh of regulations. I think that we're going to see golf carts in retirement communities that are self-driving and in sort of holiday resorts, and I look forward to that day.
I want to move to questions in 1 second, but I really want to...
You brought up this issue of self-regulation, and so I felt that I needed to clarify that, you know, when I say self-regulation, I don't use it synonymously with no regulation or no government oversight.
No, that's right.
I use it as sort of saying that there is regulation that is delegated to someone other than a government agency, and that that can be accompanied with a healthy amount of government oversight and maybe even with reporting.
And so, Joseph, this is literally your last moment as an employed person, according to Matt. So before we move to questions, a quick quick response.
Well, I guess I might as well make it good if this is my last moment. I have to basically disagree with everything that Matt just said. With respect to safety, I think that the innovation that ride-sharing has provided has actually provided greater safety than previously existed. And I'll use New York City as a specific example. I speak from experience. I'm a native New Yorker. I've taken thousands of taxi rides in the city. I can't count the amount of times I've been in a taxi where the somewhat fuzzy picture in the back in the divider, and I peek around, and that's not who's driving me at the moment. Or if I lose something in a taxi, and if I haven't taken the moment to write down the number of the taxi, I have no idea how to track down that taxi. There is so much real-time accountability that's brought about by TNCs by the use of technology, where you get a picture of the driver, you know the license card of the vehicle that you're in, you get an email. The rides are GPS tracked, so I have to strongly disagree with the assertion about safety. I think that TNCs have actually strongly elevated the safety and the transparency in the general transportation field. If I was indicating that I thought that self-driving cars are around the corner, I did not mean to indicate that, so perhaps we do have some common ground. I think it is going to take some time, but I do think it is actually going to happen.
So I want to get some questions from the audience. So could you come up to the mics just in getting... Just come up to the mic. Start with you, Sidney. Yeah.
So I wanted to go back to Arun's comment about inequality. I have a different hypothesis that a major driver in inequality is technology enabling capital to find ever more creative and efficient ways to extract profits from labor without taking any responsibility for the economic security and livelihood of those people. So... That's an alternate hypothesis. Comment, and who's going to buy all their stuff?
You know, it's a reasonable hypothesis. I mean, I think that my my narrative is the empowered entrepreneur narrative. Yours is sort of the disenfranchised drone narrative. And so, you know, both of these narratives will be true. And I think to what extent each sort of which one dominates is probably going to depend on a bunch of policy choices that we make in the near term. As we've probably discussed in the past, you know, the issue of protection of labor, whether it be sort of the things that we're proud of, like, you know, progress in society, we have sort of limited work hours, we sort of like, you know, take paid vacations, we've got income stability, we've sort of got workplace insurance of different kinds, there are health benefits, you get time off when you have a kid. I mean, a lot of these things are currently funded by full-time employment with a company or with government. A lot of them aren't sort of required by law, and so I don't think that sort of a legal intervention as we... Actually, I'm sort of jumping the gun here, but you know, we are transitioning from a world in which, like, a vast majority of the workforce is employed full-time by one corporation to a world in which, although now, like, you know, most Lyft drivers and Uber drivers and Airbnb hosts use this as supplementary, we're sort of entering a phase where more and more of the workforce is going to be freelance. And so, like, you know, whatever the effects of the sharing economy, it's sort of an imperative that we need to invent a new model for funding these protections. And that's not necessarily going to come from the platforms, and so that's a bigger question. And so I think whether or not we resolve, how we resolve that question and how well we resolve that question is going to sort of be the determinant of whether the dystopian future that you paint out actually sort of comes to bear or not.
So I want to move to the next question, but one thing that seems notable here is the comment that several sharing economy CEOs made that the best thing for their business was Obamacare.
To build off of Professor Esslin's question,
So I'm a former Lyft driver, and I'm also a student at NYU Law. And you know, you ask anyone in the streets, they'll tell you that Lyft treats their drivers better than Uber does. But neither particularly well. Like, I think Uber's taking 35% now. So my question is, have you guys heard of an app called Juno?
Yes.
And if so, what do you think about it?
Attorney-client privilege.
Maybe you should give an outline on what you think it is. So.
Well, I think you know, Juno is going to go in there and try to compete on the basis of the labor unrest, right? You know, there's an issue going on because, you know, as much as Uber and Lyft want to say they're different from the taxis and limos, they adopted the same business model in terms of independent contractors that has been in place since they deregulated the trucking industry. And I think that's a challenge because when you're running a company, right, you want to tell your employees, well, you did bad, okay, and you need to do good. And if you don't go on a certain time, you know, you can't deliver good service. Juno and is basically, I think, going to look at the issue of labor, because when you get so big, you're dealing with drivers, basically, who, if they don't have the surge price and the entity gets too big, they're going to now be making less of a wage. And this is a political issue. You know, Hillary is on record, okay, that she has issues with this, okay? Marco Rubio loves Uber. There's a philosophical debate playing out here, but I think the future is going to be aggregation. There's a new app you should keep your eye on called Carhu, which is like an Expedia or a Kayak. I think the marketplace, the next step in the marketplace, is not just the Vias and of the world. It's going to be an app which basically allows you to look at all the different taxi and limo services, which could in theory include Lyft and Uber if you ever got on, did a deal with them, that would have comparison shopping. I think that's the thing that's going to happen. And I think Juno would...
But wouldn't that drive down the price and therefore make it worse for the workers?
Well, it depends. It depends how they structure their model.
Well, why don't we just explain to people what Juno is? Yeah. Juno is a ride-sharing app like Uber or Lyft. It hasn't launched yet. It'll probably launch in the future. What they are doing now is gathering data about where people are being picked up and dropped off. What makes people excited, a small group of people who've heard of Juno excited about Juno, are two things. One is that they have committed at this point that their commissions will not be more than 10%. And the second thing that makes people excited is that they say they have reserved 50% of their employee stock for drivers. And so, you know, in some ways, I think of the airline industry and the fact that the airline industry is dependent on labor of a particular kind. And they've gone through cycles where they've realized that this labor is stronger than they think it was, and that it's also sort of like, you know, the face of the brand. And so they need to sort of give them stock in order to sort of align interests. So I think it's a promising development. I think it'll probably ripple into Lyft and Uber, and eventually there is going to be greater shared ownership of the platform from the providers. And maybe something like Juno will sort of catalyze that.
Over here on the left.
Michael Zowski. Speaking as a former TaskRabbit, I was a proud member, entrepreneur.
Are there any current providers of the sharing economy in the audience? or are they all at NYU Law now?
Yeah.
That's, I think, the point I'm trying to get at. The second that I got a decent full-time job, I never re-entered the sharing economy again. And I would think that my perspective, because of the unpredictability, my lack of control, despite the ability, the theoretical ability to accept or reject jobs and set my own rates, they were actually market set. How much of this move towards the sharing economy is really just prompted by slack in the labor market that leaves people unable to secure traditional employment? And what would happen, say, if a $1 trillion infrastructure project came and drove the real unemployment down by, you know, a couple percentage points?
What do you think? What do you think? Is your whole business based on a weak labor market?
I don't think so. You know, Lyft was, and my apologies for going to some of our talking points here, our Lyft talking points, but Lyft, the whole concept of Lyft was really trying to socialize and make mainstream the idea of carpooling. The predecessor company was a company called Zimride. That's all they did was long distance carpooling. It takes a while to build up enough critical mass till you get to that point, but our long-term vision is people as they are driving to work, you turn on the app, you give someone a ride to work, and then as you drive home, you turn on the app, you give someone a ride to your neighborhood as well. Maybe even we start seeing apps like Lyft actually being built into cars so that you don't actually have to use your phone, it's actually built into a car. So I don't see that even with the trillion-dollar infrastructure project that I would love to see, that the platform would go away, because that's never been what Lyft was trying to accomplish. Lyft was trying to fill up the 80% of empty seats that exist in cars. We viewed it as the greatest inefficiency in ground transportation and try to find a way to incentivize people and also to make people, to again, change that social norm to allow people to open up their cars to strangers. Now, to get from here to there takes some time. When I was, 2 years ago, I was dealing with comments like the ones from Matt today saying that you're no different from a taxi. There was not much to point to because at that point we only had our basic Lyft model. Two years later, we had launched Lyft Line. It was launched quicker than we thought we could, and it's become much more successful faster than we thought we could. So again, in 3 years, 5 years from now, that long-term vision of people able to use this on their own time, on their own schedule, and make a few bucks as they go about their everyday business, I still think that's going to be a successful model, yes.
And just adding really briefly to that more broadly, the sharing economy platforms we're seeing today are early examples of a different way of organizing economic activity. I don't see any way in which these are going to go away. They're just going to become more normal. And I've committed to sort of say this on every panel, but I explain this in great detail in a book that I have coming out at the end of May.
Available in stores now. One thing on the, just quickly note before we move to the next question, is that it's worth remembering that a large part of these don't involve much labor at all. So that the Airbnb, there's a little labor, but you're really selling capital. Get around. It's really just a car. And so so a large number of them, the big bulk of the sale is not labor the way it is with Uber, but it's shared capital. But it's a similar concept over here on the right.
Hi, I'm Andrew Matera. My question relates to the previous questions in terms of jobs and employment. So I've heard a lot about how the gig economy and these jobs are going to be growing and expanding in the future. And I've also heard pro-sharing economy is pro-job creation. But I just wondered if you guys could talk a little bit about the quality of jobs. I've read a lot about how Uber drivers, the majority of them, over 50% in certain localities, work less than 10 hours a week. And they're competing against taxi drivers a lot of the time in the same markets. And taxi drivers, that's a full-time job. They're supporting their family off of this, and they're competing against students, part-time workers. And if this becomes more and more popular, and the part-time gigs become more and more popular, is that going to be driving out more full-time employment opportunities and changing the nature of the jobs that we're creating?
Yes.
I mean, I think I disagree with you folks on this. I think it's not sustainable. I don't think the sharing economy, gig economy for this industry is sustainable. Right now what's happening, you have everybody looking to gather market share and fight for drivers. That's why Halo failed, because they couldn't get the fleet together. If you don't have enough drivers, this thing doesn't work. So that's why they went to a loosely regulated model, because you couldn't get the taxi and limo drivers away from where they were. So you just said, let's use people on the street. What you're seeing now with these lawsuits and these protests is gonna continue. And I think that these new companies coming in are gonna keep subsidizing their wages until the point where they can't do it anymore. Hopefully they'll be able to stop doing that after their IPOs. But they're basically stealing drivers from each other, and they all have the next new way to get the drivers. But the reality is like this gentleman said over here, that he wants a full-time job. And this is nothing new. In the 70s, yes, in the 70s, when the city was less safe, taxi drivers were a gig economy. Students are no longer driving yellow cabs. They did back then. Cops did. Okay, it's just the labor force changed, but I don't think it's sustainable as a business
but
model
I think
for a long period of time.
We've got a lot of questions, so I just want to move on over here. Katrina.
Okay, so my question is about the role for government, in particular for municipal governments going forward. So you've been talking about the sharing economy as if it's one thing, but I wonder if that's the case. Like, will the municipal role be the same in relation to all the different sectors of the sharing economy? So it was mentioned that 30 states have legislation now dealing with ride sharing. So in a lot of that legislation, I would imagine, is preempting local regulation, so curtailing the scope for municipal regulation of TNCs and actually perhaps making it more difficult for municipalities to regulate land use for transportation purposes. On the other hand, Airbnb seems to be mainly kind of within the municipal jurisdiction. So I'm kind of curious, what role do you envision the municipal authorities having over the sharing economy? Is it going to be the same for all aspects, or are there going to be variations?
I think we're going to continue to see a mix, and you're correct. There's been a lot of state legislation that is preemptive. There's been legislation that is not preemptive as well. I would say, off the top of my head, maybe two-thirds of the states that have passed legislation have been preemptive. The other third has not. We've interacted, from our perspective, good policy is good policy, whether it's local or at the state level. That being said, with respect to this industry specifically, there are aspects of it that do lend itself to be better regulated at a state level. And I'll give an example using kind of the local area. If, let's say, Westchester County and New York County and Nassau County were all to enact their own different regulatory frameworks, but they conflicted with each other. In Westchester, the car could only be 10 years old. In Nassau, the car could be 12 years old. In New York, maybe 11. What happens if you're trying to drive someone from New York City to Westchester County? And that's something that we were starting to see at the municipal level. In 2014, that's where we saw a boom in municipal legislation, and we were engaging and trying to get good policy passed, and we were happy to do so. But when we started to see conflicts between localities, that's where the push for state regulation really started to come about. And we do think that state legislation, for that reason, does tend to make better sense for this particular industry. But the same may not be true for the Airbnbs of the world.
The one other thing to add to that is that it's regulation. It's not just of industries, but it's of type of things. So labor is regulated largely at the state level. Taxi regulation still, even in institutions, largely at the local level. So I think it's right, but it's not just going to be which type of firm, but which type of product, which part of the company.
And I'll quickly add to that a lot of the reason for that was because there had to be some changes to insurance law as well, which is always done at the state level. So that was a necessity.
Joe, you have a tough job. There's no question about it. I mean, look, I have to just point out and just call it for what it is. There still is no difference between a taxi and a limo and a TNC or an Uber and Lyft. It's the same thing as a person getting in a car, going from point A to point B. When it comes to public safety, is that driver safe? Are they competent? Is the insurance? I don't understand why taxis and limos can't be part of the TNC law. Let's call it what it is. This has nothing to do with...
Perhaps it's because the TNC law didn't work that well.
Well
cabs were very expensive.
But David, that's not what happened. What happened is, and I guarantee you this, they've spent more probably they've guaranteed to have probably, and I'd like to footnote and research.
Guaranteed to probably, I like that.
Paid more money into the coffers of politicians and lobbyists. I don't think there's any question. Look, the industry did it for a million years, but now they're the bigger new kid on the block. But let's get back to why this happened. This happened because the regulators at the municipal level were stopping them from operating. So they went over their heads, had a lobbying campaign where Uber and Lyft were working together to get laws that only applied to them when there is really no distinction. The definition of a TNC says basically what a taxi and limo does, and then it says, but this shall not include taxi and limo. So you basically, it's an anti-competitive law, number one. And every time I ask you to explain the difference, you bring up New York City, which is the only city where you and Uber were forced to comply with the laws that everybody else did. So why are you killing these guys now? I mean, they really are on the ropes, the taxi and limo. Just let them become TNCs too, right? I mean, why can't you just do that?
So a couple of points on that, Matt. We have never stood in the way of whatever legislation is appropriate or regulation is appropriate for other industries. We have never weighed in on that. If taxis need to be regulated differently, more power to them. The one thing I will point out, and I know that you know this given your former position, is that all the examples that you just raised, whether it's taxis, black cars, liveries, limousines, here in New York City, here at the TLC level, they are all regulated differently. That means there's already been a determination that even though all those different forms of transportation do the same thing, as you say, they transport someone from point A to point B, there has been a determination that each of those industries have enough differences that require different regulations.
Yes.
So it becomes a question of degree. But TNCs are different.
I agree with him generally, David. I agree with you generally, Joe, but when it comes to background checks and insurance, please give me a good reason why one person's life in a car is worth more or less, or why someone should be getting into a car that has a less of an inferior background check. Just answer the question.
So let me ask you a question, though, while we're at it. So, sure. Which is that do you think that, so we got a question about, is this a product of a slack labor market? Would Uber and Lyft have been successful if the medallion system hadn't limited the number of taxis too excessively?
I think so, yeah. I mean, there's a bump in the quality level. I mean, I think that, like, you know, the supply limit certainly helped things along.
I was just being a jerk.
This was sort of a...
can we move over here?
I didn't understand the rhetoric nature of the question.
I was just being a jerk. Go ahead.
Okay, so... a lot, but so I actually work in the airline industry, so it's interesting to hear you guys bring that up once in a while, which is arguably one of the most regulated industries out there, like on a federal and municipal level, and so many parallels, especially since a lot of those regulations came out in the past 50, 100 years, like safety, labor, antitrust, pricing. So I was just wondering what parallels you see there and what learnings you think there are. And I actually found it interesting that you said Lyft isn't anti-regulation because similarly, it was the airline, like the major airlines that asked for government regulation to begin with, and then there was sort of like regret there. So so just wondering what your thoughts are with what similarities do you think there are? What do you think is going to be similar? What do you think is going to be different?
Well, I'll sort of point to sort of the one sort of narrow thread of similarity that I was trying to highlight. You know, I mean, they're both transportation industries, and you know, I'm sure that there are tons of, you know, they are very different industries in many ways, despite both being transportation industries. The point of similarity that I was bringing up was that, you know, there's a very there's a very strong dependence that a corporate airline has on its pilots, right? And in a, like, you know, as a consequence, and the pilots know this, and pilots have powerful unions, these unions often get powerful enough that they can extract all of the profits in a down year of the corporate parent, and then the airline goes bankrupt. This sort of, we've seen cycles of this. And then the airline says, well, how do we prevent this from happening again? Well, let us sort of align the incentives of the pilots with sort of the survival of the corporate entity by making them shareholders. And so the parallel I was pointing out was that we've got a new company, Juno, that is going to compete with Uber and Lyft, that is thinking about making their providers, their drivers, shareholders in their company. So it's almost like they've leapfrogged a couple of points, and that's the similarity I saw. But I'm not an expert by any means on sort of like, you know, aviation regulation, so I wouldn't be able to sort of make any further generalizations.
So we have time for one more question. So
thank you for really interesting conversation. First, an observation that we've heard from several millennials who have their doubts. Yeah. So I'm among them, just barely.
Are they voting for Bernie Sanders?
Yes. So I think that a question that initially was touched on, but I'd like to hear more about, is about the sharing of data that these companies are collecting about their operations and what the argument really is that they shouldn't be sharing it with our city governments. In particular, I think in light of what's been discussed about how they are sort of in effect creating infrastructure, and it makes me uneasy to think that venture capital firms are gonna decide what infrastructure my city should have. That's not really how I think that should work. And I think I sort of another layer of that is if we are moving towards like an idyllic setup where these companies have the potential to redistribute the means of production, isn't data part of that as well? And so how does that fit in?
I'm very glad you brought that back up. We agree, and we've actually begun to start sharing data with transit planners in different and transit agencies in different cities. It's something that happens slowly. Number one, as I think I mentioned before, when you have a new industry like this, it takes a little while before you get to the point where the data is of any sort of legitimate value. So, and again, this is still a very new industry, but we have begun that process, and we're actually really excited to see what it can show and how it can help in terms of planning, whether it's transportation, urban planning, just generally speaking. It's something that you have to be very careful about. You're dealing with a lot of potentially private information. There's a lot of privacy concerns involved. There's also specifically like geolocation data, which is something that you want to be very careful about. And frankly, there's competitive issues, so you have to be careful about that too, because you don't want your competitor to get a hold of your data and try to get a competitive advantage on you. But that being said, this is something that we've already begun striking partnerships along those lines, and we're really excited to see what those partnerships yield.
And in exciting news, that's the subject of panel two. So thank you all very much.